Hello everyone, thank you for joining the MIFPLUS Plus seminar again, now in 2022. So I will talk today about geographic style maps of lattices extracted from crystals in the Cambridge Structural Database, and this is joint work with Matt and Andy in the Materials Innovation Factory at Liverpool. Since I gave a few similar talks earlier, so only briefly remind the key concepts of a lattice, which is a collection of all linear integer combinations of linear bases, generally in Rn, although these pictures, of course, show on two-dimensional lattices, actually all equivalent to each other, all square lattices, equivalent up to rigid motion or isometry. So this is a key concept motivated by rigidity of real structures, or more exactly by the fact that crystal structures are determined in a rigid form. That's why it's very natural to study them up to rigid motion. We also include reflections only for convenience, actually, because you will see that our classifications also work in the case of rigid motion without mirror reflections. But if we for a moment consider any composition of rotations, translations, and reflections, then modulo with isometries, we get the space, lattice isometry space, consisting of all isometric classes of lattices. And this is really an infinite collection and a continuous space, as you will see a bit later. So what's a bit more formally a problem? The problem is to understand this continuous space in terms of a following map or a complete isometry invariant. So we'd like to map this space into some simpler space. So in the case of two-dimensional lattices, this space will have three parameters. In the three-dimensional case, up to six parameters. And these are the important properties that we would like to satisfy. So of course, it should be an invariant. So if lattices are isometric, so not distinguishable up to rigid motion or reflections as well, then the invariant takes the same value. Completeness is much harder. So the invariant should really distinguish all non-isometric lattices. And also you will see that it is possible to define a metric on lattices satisfying the metric axioms here. Right, so brief review, a brief reminder of the past work. So especially by Larry and Herbert more than 40 years ago now. So our most recent versions are available at my webpage, so this address. So we already have four papers subdivided into different paths for two dimensions, but also for mathematicians with all proofs, lemmas and derivations, etc., and less technical papers only reminding key concepts and providing these new visual maps, so similarly separately for two dimensions and three dimensions. So it might be easier if you would like to look at latest version, simply go to my web page, navigate to the periodic geometry and topology subpage, and then they're linked at the top. Okay, let me remind you the key concept of a super base and obtuse super base. If you start from any basis, actually in Rn, in any dimension, then we could easily add the extra vector equal to the negative sum of the n vectors from v1 to vn. For example, in two dimensions, we start from two vectors, we get one more. So you have v1, v2, and then one more minus v1 minus v2. It's very natural to consider so-called obtuse superbases. Obtuse means that all pairwise angles in these superbases should be obtuse or 90 degrees, so not acute, more exactly. And so how many angles do you have? In dimension two, we have three vectors, so three pairwise angles. In dimension three, there will be four vectors in superbase and six pairwise angles. So this picture shows so-called Voronoi domains in yellow and actually illustrates all possible obtuse superbases up to isometry. For example, in the generic case, when our Voronoi domain is hexagonal, when we have exactly two super bases, V1, V2, V0, and opposite one, centrally symmetric with respect to the origin. The rectangular lattice is really here a single or a special case when we have four different super bases. So we split into similar two classes of centrally symmetric super bases, but for example, these two are not related by rigid motion. So there is only a reflection, mirror reflection between them. Now, how do we construct invariants from these super bases? So we simply take a negative scalar products of these super bases. They were known as Selin parameters, or more exactly negative Selin parameters. Later, by convergence law, they were called conorms. So there is a mathematical reason for that. And what we have done, we have simply taken the square root additionally of this non-negative conorms to get units in the original vector coordinates, for example, in angstroms. So now we have in dimension two, three root products. And to get a proper invariant, we should put them in increasing order. So you will see examples shortly. But the classification now becomes rather simple. So the root invariant consists of three root products in increasing order, and it does not depend on a choice of our two super base. Actually, from the previous slide, it might be almost obvious to you, especially in a generic case when you have only two symmetric obtuse super bases. Well, because scalar products, of course, are preserved up to isometry. So formally, the theorem says that any lattices in two dimensions are isometric if and only if these root invariants coincide. We have slightly changed the notations from our previous talks, so now we call them root invariants to highlight indeed the invariant's nature. Okay, examples for all square lattice. So square lattice with a minimum interpoint distance a. So rather simple. Natural obtuse superbase, and the root invariant is 0AA. So here, 0 means that two vectors are orthogonal. Hexagonal lattice, so the basis is a bit more complicated. However, the root invariant is in a sense simpler. So we have three equal numbers. And here, A is again the minimum interpoint distance in the lattice. If there are any questions, feel free to ask. I'll continue. So now we consider we would like to distinguish lattices not only up to isometry but up to rigid motion. So we'd like to see mirror images of a lattice differently, and to distinguish them we need something new. So I didn't see this concept before, but maybe you could tell me if there is a reference. So if a lattice is mirror symmetric, so mirror symmetric means that it can't be mapped to itself by a mirror reflection, when we define its sign as zero, because in that case, of course, there is nothing to distinguish from a lattice between a lattice and its mirror image. But if it's not mirror symmetric, then consequently an obtuse superbase should have vectors of different lengths. So if you have vectors of the same length, then there is a symmetry in the lattice. So in that case, we could choose two vectors of shortest length, so V1, V2. And we define the sign as the sign of the determinant of the matrix where V1, V2 are the columns. So this picture gives an example. So for this lattice, that's an obtuse superbase, V1, V2 are shorter than V0. And if you could quickly imagine a lattice, the determinants of the matrix V1, V2, then you'll see that it has determinant positive. That's why you have a positive sign for the root invariant on the left, but the negative sign for its mirror image on the right. So here the two shortest vectors are u1 and u0. So that's why when we take these two vectors into a matrix, we get a negative determinant. So this sign can be determined or can be defined in actually many different ways. So previously we used this a more geometric, but I think slightly more complicated definition. So if you're interested in more details in the paper, there is actually a separate lemma discussing how to compute it or how to visualize lattices of different signs. And with a sign, we can extend our root invariant to the oriented root invariant. So we simply use this sign as a superscript. And if sign is zero, usually we simply skip it, well, because it's not relevant. And another extension of the previous theorem, this oriented root invariant is complete up to rigid motion. So the previous root invariant plus essentially the orientation plus the sign are enough to distinguish lattices up to rigid motion. Now let's go closer to the maps. So how can we visualize all root invariants? So root invariants are ordered triples. So we usually fix indices in this way. So R12 is the smallest. Then we have a three-dimensional space, so three coordinate axes with root products, and all these ordered triples, they live in the triangular cone. So these are boundary lines of the triangular cone. So we only exclude one coordinate axis here, where R01 is exactly zero. So you will see. Maybe it's already obvious. If these two root products are zeros, then the lattice simply degenerates. So it cannot be a real two-dimensional lattice. Okay, so for any triple here, we have an invariant. And what is more important, from this triple, we could reconstruct our lattice, or reconstruct a basis. So this might be, so I'm not sure if it's completely obvious, but again, I refer to our papers where we give specific examples how to reconstruct a lattice from this triple, or even better, from simpler pictures. So now let's project this cone, because this cone is three-dimensional, so it's not easy to look at. Let's divide this triple by the sum of coordinates, by the sum of root products. So I called it the size. So if you would like to suggest a better name, that's fine. I think it's a bit better than, for example, unit cell area, or even the square root of unit cell area, because this is a sort of a uniform measure of size of a lattice. So similarly in angstroms. So when we divide, when we project our triangular cone by scaling by this factor, we get a point in this yellow triangle. So this yellow triangle is in the plane when the sum of coordinates is exactly one. So now let's look at this triangle in a bit different way. So here it is shown as 1/6 of that large triangle. So the projected values are denoted by bar here. And this quotient triangle can be considered simply in the plane. And we propose actually simpler coordinates to parameterize this quotient triangle. So the quotient triangle here can be parameterized by x and y expressed in the previous projected coordinates as follows. So x is the difference between two largest projected values. So it's not negative, and also not greater than one, because we divided by the size. And y, the second coordinate, so it's simply a scaling in the vertical direction. So on the previous slide, you see the maximum vertical coordinate was 1/3, but we have realized that it's much more convenient to have an isosceles triangle. That's why we multiplied by 3. And you could easily check that, yes, the sum x plus y is not greater than 1. So we indeed get this isosceles triangle. So it follows from the fact that our original triple was ordered. Okay, so this quotient triangle QT, so it actually contains contains classes of lattices considered up to similarity, so up to isometry and uniform scaling. So that scaling from the previous slide is equivalent to scaling of the whole lattice. For example, so you might remember that the square lattice had the root invariant 0 AA, and when we plug in these numbers into x and y, we get simply 0, 0. So what first scalar product 0 becomes 0 equal to y, and two equal root products become 0 for x. So all square lattices project to the origin to the right angled vertex of this QT. Hexagonal lattice project to the top vertex. And what else? Rectangular lattices. So rectangular lattices with a unit cell AB, they have root invariant 0 AB. And you could easily compute what the projected invariant could be any number in this horizontal side. So all rectangular lattices, so Bravais class OP, lay here on the bottom edge. Centered rectangular lattices, they are, so computations are a bit more complicated, so that's why I only say what lie here in the vertical edge and in the hypotenuse. So two open edges formally. And a corollary of the original classification theorem for similarity, so it says that two lattices are similar if and only if these projected invariants, so in coordinates x and y, coincide. Any questions on this map showing all Bravais classes? So hopefully familiar notations for crystallographers. So concerning inverse design, the paper, well, the mathematics part at the moment, but we would like to include also some simpler examples in the crystallography part. So we can take any point in the triangle, say x, y, and reconstruct a lattice. So if you also fix a size sigma from the previous slide, then x, y, and sigma will uniquely determine a lattice up to isometry. So there are examples of this inverse design or reconstruction in the mathematics part of the two-dimensional paper.
So just to check my understanding there, Vitaly, this doesn't take any motifs into account, does it? So if you were to double like the edge length of a square lattice, then they would only have two shared root invariants.
Cameron, you're absolutely right. What we consider lattices, and yes, by definition, a lattice can be considered as a periodic point set or a periodic crystal with a motif of a single point. Yes. So a unit cell contains only one point. However, thank you for mentioning general periodic crystals. So I was going to make a connection plan, but maybe it can be already obvious. So if you have a more general periodic point set, so nonetheless, it has a lattice, right? And this periodic point set can still be visualized on the same triangular map. So of course, we collapse, so we disregard the motif in this way. But what is important, we have meaningful coordinates. So original root products are measured in angstroms. So here coordinates are unitless only because we consider them up to similarity. But nonetheless, they are still meaningful. So they can be connected to original sizes or ratios from the original crystal. Mm-hmm. But you're right, Cameron, we focus on lattices.
Yeah. Okay, so there's sort of like an assumed reduction before we do this.
Yeah, another good question. So we start from any obtuse superbase.
Okay, yeah.
And yes, you're right, like an initial base of a lattice could be rather arbitrary. However, we rely on many existing algorithms to reduce these bases. To get into a reduced form and so-called reduced basis or Nigris reduced basis, they're actually in a one-to-one correspondence with obtuse superbases,
cool.
which is formally proved in the mathematical part of the two-dimensional paper. So yes, so practically when we start from an arbitrary crystal or a lattice, we first reduce, take an obtuse superbase, and then compute invariance.
Cool. All right, thanks a lot for that.
Yes. Okay. Then, we consider lattices not up to isometry but up to rigid motion, we get roughly twice larger lattices. Well, in what sense?
Can I have a question of the previous slide?
Sure.
I mean, what is? Can you explain, let's say, from a crystallographic point of view, this division between the two types of orthorhombic C center that we have?
So imagine there is actually a continuous deformation here. So starting from a square lattice, if you rotate it 45 degrees, so it could be also imagined with a non-primitive unit cell and a point inside, right? I think later I actually have a picture exactly for that, but hopefully it's familiar. So when we increase with one side of a non-primitive unit cell, so it becomes rectangular, so no longer square, it's rectangular, and I have even highlighted with a rectangular non-primitive conventional, probably it's conventional for the hexagonal lattice. Right, so it's continuous deformation here from a square lattice to a hexagonal lattice. And we have more lattices on the diagonal because you see we have two parameters. With conventional non-primitive cell is rectangle 2a times 2b, right? And for the hexagonal lattice, so there is a singular point where b equals a times root 3. But if you increase b even further, then our conventional cell becomes even more elongated. So I have shown it vertically. So b is that vertical size. So it becomes even larger. And then we increase, we could increase here b formally up to infinity, right? We have a very long vertical conventional conventional non-primitive unit cell, so centered for a centered rectangular lattice. And that's why this point here is excluded, because it's the limit case when B becomes infinite or infinite relative to A. So B is the vertical size and A is the horizontal size.
Could I make a comment about in terms of crystallography?
Mm-hmm.
And that is that if you look at the central area of the triangle, that represents all lattices, as you say. But along the line, particularly from the square to the hexagonal, you've now added constraints that add a different kind of symmetry and that allow you to go to the rectangular symmetry of the centered lattices. So basically, by restricting, you've added new symmetry on those two lines.
Of course, you're absolutely right. Exactly. So actually, it's convenient to say right here. So the boundary of this triangle, so the boundary, of course, excluding this infinite point, this boundary represents all mirror symmetric lattices. So lattices that map to itself under mirror reflection.
Perfect.
Yes. Right. So that's why when we can see the mirror images, so formally, we have now two triangles. So one for positive lattices, one for negative lattices. But these two triangles should be glued together along the common boundary representing all mirror symmetric lattices. So of course, it's not easy to glue them, but I have glued them along the hypotenuse, along with blue hypotenuse. So I have left two pairs of edges, not glued, but indicated that we should identify the left edge with the top edge and the bottom edge with the right edge. Okay, so exactly because any rectangular lattice is mirror symmetric to itself, and similarly, any centered rectangle. But if you take a point inside a generic oblique lattice, then its mirror image is different up to rigid motion. So they are not equivalent up to rigid motion, only up to isometry. Is this idea understandable? Okay, so adding this sign, of course, extends the projected invariant, and that's how we get a complete invariant up to now orientation preserving similarity. So it means a composition of rotations, translations, and a uniform scaling, but no reflections. Okay, so far you have seen only theoretical maps, right? So almost pure mathematics. But now you will see maps with real lattices. So what do we mean by real? We take a three-dimensional crystal from the Cambridge structural database, yes, three-dimensional. To represent two-dimensional lattices, we take three pairs of basis vectors. So we have initially three basis vectors and take three pairs. So we get three two-dimensional lattices. Well, we consider them still real as real because they appear in real crystals. But a bit later, yeah, hopefully even today, you will see more complicated maps for real three-dimensional lattices, not only in two dimensions. So what you might be interested to see is actually what points of this quotient square are covered by real lattices.
Could I ask a question on that quotient square as well? So given that you have the quotient square with a point missing at 0, 1, could that be redrawn to just be a planar diagram with the hexagon in the middle and then going outwards that way?
Okay. Topologically, it is a sphere without a point.
Yeah, and yeah.
You will see other geographic style maps. So I promised.
Okay, yeah.
I promised geographic
style. Getting ahead of myself. Okay, cool.
Okay, but first map of all two-dimensional lattices extracted from CSD. So three lattices per crystal. That's why we get a big number. But we take only, of course, only crystals that have a well-defined lattice, because you know in the Cambridge structural database, not every crystal has full necessary data, but still it is, you see, 2.6 million approximately. Now, the square is the quotient square. Let me explain the color. So the color here in the logarithmic scale. Logarithmic, so one, so white for one, then yellow for 10, then 100, 1,000, 10,000, right? So it's the exponential increase here. So despite our attempt to, use this logarithmic scale, actually you might notice rather quickly that many lattices appear on this horizontal edge. So these are rectangular lattices. So indeed, there are many of them, and we'll show them actually separately. But for a moment, you see a lot of rectangular lattices, all these black pixels represent rectangular lattices. Also, quite a lot centered rectangular on the diagonal and on this vertical edge. But oblique lattices are also well represented. About 45% of them, almost a half, are generic oblique, and you might notice a slight preference for positive lattices. So far we have no explanation, but we can easily explain with the sparsity in this corner. Well, might be already obvious to you. So you remember this infinite point comes when we have a very elongated cell. And of course, in real lattices, it doesn't happen that we have very narrow cells. So that's why we have sparse regions here, but closer to more natural, more symmetric lattices. So almost, yeah, everything is possible here. Any questions on that first density map? Okay, then I think we consider them, subsets. So actually, when we remove mirror symmetric lattices, when we consider only oblique lattices, so we have removed this horizontal edge, we removed the vertical edge, and now it's a bit easier to look not at the logarithmic scale, but at the usual scale. So now every pixel by the color shows the number of lattices from 0 to approximately 150. And one pixel size here is 0.125 angstroms, so 1/8 of a single angstrom. So what does it mean? It means that we are counting lattices whose projected invariants xy, so coordinates xy, are in a very small bin of size 1/8 of a single angstrom. So here we load with mirror symmetric lattices. Warm up is a bit maybe easier to see in the normal scale. So we still have a preference towards with centered rectangular lattices closer to the hexagonal lattices at the top left corner. And still you see it's a big number, more than 1 million. Even if you divide by three, it is still a lot in the Cambridge structural database. Okay, then and now we visualize primitive rectangular lattices. So unit cells A times B. So you have only two parameters and we show them. So without invariance in a simpler way. So A, B, B is greater than A. So this is again a continuous map of these pairs AB for all rectangular lattices. As you see, there is a preference to be closer to the diagonal. So A equals B means that we have a square lattice. But many pairs are possible apart from, as you can expect, apart from pairs where A and B is very small. So in that case, so you see less than 5 angstroms, it's rather hard to get any unit cell from the CSD. Okay, centered rectangle lattices. Similarly, let me see. Matt, I think there is a potential typo here because we should plot here A and B, right? So am I right that we look at the map of A, B? Because we have...
Sorry, I must have just not updated
No problem. So it's so it's again A and B. A is in the previous plot, and the diagonal means that A equals B. So this is so in that case, am I right that we have square lattices again? Yeah, I think so. And even on the logarithmic scale, we have a lot of square lattices. Yes, but outside the diagonal, yes, it looks continuous. Now, even simpler subspaces. So if you look only at square lattices, so what's the histogram of side lengths? Up to 50 angstroms. So again, everything here is measured in angstroms and you have a peak at about 10 angstroms, not large. So I'm not sure if it was expected or not by real experts, but yeah, that's how they change. The hexagonal lattices, so it's a much smaller number. So exactly hexagonal, which means that Matt, are they marked as, or did you compute them as hexagonal with a small threshold for floating point errors? Okay, so since it is a much smaller number, then of course a histogram is much noisier than in the previous case. So that's, but nonetheless, we have roughly a continuous spectrum with some well big outliers.
Yeah, that plot is exact rather than with tolerance. Which is why it's small.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's if the D6 chirality is less than is equal to zero.
I see. So exactly hexagonal. Simply, yeah. I guess up to last decimal place.
Yeah.
Then, so I promised geographic style coordinates, and indeed we could use on our triangle many coordinates, so not necessarily this x and y. So since the quotient square is indeed a topological sphere without a single point, then it would be very natural to consider it as a round sphere. And the boundary in this case becomes the equator of this round sphere because this equator separates two parts. So the positive part, the northern hemisphere, and the negative part, the southern hemisphere. So from first picture to the second, I consider for a moment only the initial positive quotient triangle, and we need to choose actually a north pole. So maybe later we might have actually a vote for a north pole, but if you use only Euclidean geometry, then a natural choice is to take the in center, the center of the inscribed circle in this triangle. Putting this point, so that's actually a lattice, and I, again, on the paper, I have reconstructed with basis explicitly. It's close to a rectangular, but not exactly. Because it's a generic lattice. And then the equator is the boundary of our quotient triangle. And on that boundary, we have hexagonal lattices, square lattices. So you see here shown in two different ways. So also in terms of this non-primitive twice larger cell. And also the infinite point, so that empty point is excluded, but it provides a natural direction how to measure geographic style coordinates. So since this point is excluded, then it's a natural choice for the so-called Greenwich meridian. So going through the North Pole straight to the equator, so there is a centered rectangular lattice, so here called G, so which could be reconstructed exactly, and all rather simple angles around this equator, they represent all mirror symmetric lattices on the equator. So finally, let's look at this picture in three dimensions. So we have the northern hemisphere sphere of positive lattices and the southern hemisphere of negative lattices. And for example, we could use traditional coordinates, so longitude lambda and latitude phi. Any questions?
What lattice do you get at point P plus?
P plus. So I have drawn it briefly.
Oh, yeah, I see.
So that's how it looks. In the paper, yes, there are exact coordinates for a basis, so how to reconstruct it explicitly. So it looks like that. But I agree that this is a choice. So in principle, we could choose any P. I have chosen the in center simply because angles are rather simple to compute. So we see 45 degrees and twice smaller, because here we have bisectors of all angles. So only for that reason, I have taken the North Pole at the in center. Okay, and actually the coordinates of that G point on the vertical axis are also rather simple. So this is simply tan of pi over 8. So this angle 22 and a half. So that's the tangent of that angle. Okay. Okay, so sorry, we haven't produced maps on a round sphere yet, so maybe next time, but now let's move to three dimensions. Because yes, I hope to give you similar maps in a more complicated three-dimensional case. So in three dimensions, we have super base of four vectors, and then six scalar products, so six root products. So if you have ordered superbase vectors, when we put these root products into the 2x3 matrix as follows. So we call it a root form, which is not yet an invariant. So we have a separate concept of an invariant. So why is it not an invariant? Because when we permute vectors of a superbase, of course our lattice remains the same, but the matrix changes, right? So it's not yet an invariant, but a simple example. If you have a primitive orthorhombic lattice with these basis vectors, then the root form is rather simple. Three zeros at the top and ABC at the bottom. If you start reordering vectors, then we get 24 permutations. So please notice 24, not 6 factorial. So not all permutations are possible, only 24. And this gives us the opportunity to uniquely order root products, at least in the generic case. So we have preferred increasing order in the top row, but it's a choice. Okay. So we need to consider the lattices on three dimensions by the Voronoi types, but only five. So previously, of course, Delaunay produced even more, 24 types. So it also makes sense, but for our classification, five types are enough. So the key question here is how to state this invariance result. So in what sense with Rij, root product isometry invariance. So I have discussed mathematical details, how to get an invariant in the previous talk in December. So today I'll only briefly mention the simplest, well, still actually non-trivial case of Voronoi type V5, and then move to maps. So if you have a primitive orthorhombic lattice with a unit cell rectangular box, cuboid, ABC, then we could have actually several non-isometric obtuse superbases. So if all ABC are different, then we could get four different, not equivalent up to isometry obtuse superbases, and they have the following root forms. So one you have seen before, but we could also get this three, which means that it's not enough to consider 24 permutations, because 24 permutations coming from reordering vectors, they do not make these four root forms equivalent. Right? So we need something extra. And well, in this case, it's rather easy. We have three non-zero numbers. So we simply define the invariant for V5, Voronoi type V5 lattices as we order a triple ABC. For other types, we also need to do something extra. So similarly, because of that ambiguity. So not covered today, partially covered previously, but in each case we define a root invariant, and the main result, similarly to two dimensions, says that two lattices, any lattices on three dimensions are isometric, if and only if with root invariants coincide. Okay, this is only a statement, no time for proof, but let me explain how we could visualize this Voronoi type V5. So which is already quite large, let me explain. So we have three parameters, ABC in increasing order, and V5 has a cuboid cell, root invariant is simple. How could we visualize these three numbers? So in principle, we could put them again into the triangular cone as before, as we did with ordered triples in two dimensions, but maybe even simpler, as actually Larry suggested, well, take simpler ratios, A over C, B over C, right? So this will be numbers between 0 and 1. And also we remove the dependence on scale. So it's up to similarity. Then within this collection, we have three Bravais classes. So simplest possible primitive cubic lattices when ABC are equal, when on that map, they all project to the point 1, 1. Okay, more general class primitive tetragonal lattices when two parameters are equal. So in that case, we will see a diagonal or the top horizontal line. So actually rather similar to the centered rectangular case. So two lines. And Bravais class OP, primitive orthorhombic, they will be generic internal points in this triangle. So what triangle? So that's the triangle. So AC, B over C. So these are all lattices, three-dimensional now, extracted from crystals in the Cambridge Structural Database. So about 157,000 lattices shown in the normal scale. So simple cubic lattices at that point. So well, quite many of them, but also a lot on that diagonal. So what does it mean? Let me see. Tetragonal, yeah, this is the tetragonal Bravais class here. Yes. And all internal points here are for primitive orthorhombic. Right. So see, we have unitless coordinates, unitless ratios here. Nonetheless, a ratio cannot be very small, because if it is a small ratio, our cell is elongated and this is unrealistic. That's why this area is, this region on the left is sparse. But as before, almost everything is possible apart from these natural restrictions, yeah, because of, well, our physical world. So that's the normal scale. Now, what happens if we remove, let me see, what did we remove here? Ah, no, so this is simply the logarithmic scale. This is the logarithmic scale, so exactly the same map as before, but Matt, am I right? But we simply change the scale. And
yes, this is, you said this is just the base 10 log of the count mm-hmm. in each pixel now is being mm-hmm. is being displayed.
Yes. So it's yeah. maybe a bit easier to see what there are many lattices also in the more generic class.
I guess you see as you get to the more comfortable, the less they start to sort of thin out. It's easier yes. to see that as you get to yeah. the more restricted, the kind of sillier areas.
Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Right. Then the next. OP. Yeah. Am I right? Yes. In this OP plot, we have removed cubic lattices and removed also all lattices from the diagonal and the top edge. So pure OP Prove class. So primitive for rhombic lattices, and they are easier to see, yeah, because previously we had a lot, so the density map was skewed because of large numbers and too many black pixels on the diagonal. But now it's a bit even easier to see that we have many and some concentrations of primitive for rhombic lattices outside the singular diagonal case. Okay. Now, simple cubic lattices, yeah, not a big number, 4,000. And that's how the sites are distributed. Also, I would say rather continuously. Okay, so we are almost finishing. So let me remind actually the key motivation for this approach to map lattices continuously. So it comes from an even larger map. So Cameron briefly mentioned earlier. So when we have periodic crystals, so here I mean periodic crystals only, it's very natural to map them to periodic point sets by taking only atomic centers, right? And this picture from Richard Feynman's book, his famous lectures on physics. So the very first lecture on atomic theory includes that picture, which I scanned as an illustration. So what Richard here demonstrated, that we could consider different crystals with rather similar geometry, so all cubic lattices. But even if we forget about chemical elements, these geometric structures, they differ by geometry. So they differ by distances to neighbors in that particular case. So and this was a visual hint from Richard Feynman to consider that map and check that indeed all crystals can be distinguished only by looking at centers and not using even chemical elements. So that's why we came to this crystal isometry space, so formally defined the space of isometry classes containing all known and undiscovered crystals. The lattice isometry space is a projection from that much larger space to a simpler space. So that's why it's very important to understand the simpler space, lattice isometry space, because later all crystals will be projected and viewed on these quotient triangles, quotient squares, and maps we have shown previously. Of course, we do not claim that every periodic point set is a realistic crystal, of course not, because, for example, distances should be large enough between atoms. So that's for sure. So another analogy here. So this crystal isometry space or lattice isometry space, they give a map, so where to look for potential crystals. So similarly, when we have a map of the universe, you do not expect that at every point in the space there is a star. So stars are rather sparse, but it's still valuable to have a map to understand how these stars are distributed and actually where to look for new stars. Okay, so the crystal isometries principle was experimentally verified by computing invariants that I didn't mention today, PDD, on all periodic crystals in the CSD. So we simply, we didn't even test the principle, we test the invariants here, how strong these invariants are. And we have found five, I call them actually needles in a haystack, because, you know, Cambridge Structural Database is simply a list of C files. And in this list, huge list of C files, we have found five pairs whose geometric, but were identically geometrically, but chemically different. So very simple, very small difference in each case, one atom is replaced by another atom. So it was actually a test more for the invariants. So we expected that crystal isometry principle should be, should hold anyway, even if these invariants are weak enough, but these invariants turned out to be rather strong. Okay, to finish early and have more time for discussion, our final conclusion, well, a summary, what we have discovered in this continuous maps. So yes, you have seen a preference for high symmetry lattices. Of course, probably it was expected. So every crystallographer knows that symmetry is important and you have a lot. But nonetheless, almost a half, 45%, belongs to the Bravais class MP, oblique lattices or generic case. Only 2% for square lattices and even a much smaller proportion for hexagonal lattices. Matt, do you have an update for rectangular lattices?
I should mention that these numbers are for precise things. So I've just out of interest calculated to within a 1 in a million angstrom tolerance, which rather changes the picture a little bit. So there are then rather more hexagonal lattices. It goes up to 5%.
Oh, even okay.
There are 48% of lattices are rectangular. 6% are square and 6% are centered rectangular. So rectangular in terms of like the 2D projection as to within 1 in a million. So it's worth noting that a lot of crystals that we calculate in the kind of continuous space are very close to symmetric.
Yes.
In terms of maps. So kind of easily just a little bit perturbed away from it.
Okay, very good. So thank you very much, Matt, for your last minute update. So let me actually finish. Let me finish recording, and then we'll have a longer discussion with questions. So if I